These days, even while television has been rapidly approaching, and even according to some, surpassing film as an art form, it can still be somewhat easy to take the formats of TV, movie, and miniseries for granted. You know, rarely a year goes by without a new biographical movie or literary miniseries being announced for HBO or the History Channel. But all formats have to start somewhere, and in this installment of the Lincoln on Screen retrospective, we will be taking a look at Sandburg's Lincoln, which was not just the first miniseries made about the life of the 16th president, but also the first miniseries ever made for television. Sandburg's Lincoln is a 5-hour miniseries that was originally broadcast on NBC in 6 50-minute installments in the year 1974. Starring in the title role is Hal Holbrook, a fine actor most well-known for his stage and television work, but still had a few high-profile roles in movies like All the President's Men, where he played Deep Throat, and his recent Oscar-nominated role in Into the Wild. With such a long and illustrious career, it's a little disappointing that this performance, which won Hal Holbrook his 3rd Emmy for Best Actor, has been largely overlooked in recent years, especially among Lincoln portrayals. That really is a shame, because I feel confident in saying that his performance as Abraham Lincoln is the best portrayal I've seen yet. I have to give the makeup artist credit for doing such an uncanny job at recreating Lincoln's features on Holbrook's face, and Holbrook himself does a fantastic job of capturing the persona of Abraham Lincoln. We finally get a real attempt at the Kentucky accent, but more than that, we get a sense of Lincoln as a very human man, self-deprecating and aware of his weaknesses, and always ready with a joke or anecdote that he can use to try to make a point. As a result, this is probably the most upbeat Lincoln I've ever seen. This is almost to a fault. I mean, Lincoln's always working hard on something, he's always in the process of doing something in this miniseries, and as a result, we really don't get a sense of his depression or melancholy that we have seen in the other movies. The only real thing that Holbrook doesn't have in his performance and resemblance as Lincoln is the height. I mean, he's no slouch, so to speak. He's 6'1", but that doesn't allow him to tower over the other people around him. Most of the people seem to be around the same height. And also, as you might have been able to tell from the picture I showed you, he really doesn't have the same kind of skinny face that Lincoln does, but really, those are just quibbles. Physical appearance doesn't make that big of a difference, and really does not distract from the fantastic performance that Hopper gives. The first episode of the series covers Lincoln's presidential campaign, and later his first inauguration as president. Now, we never get a real sense of how controversial that election was, but we do get a good idea of how elections were run in the 19th century. I mean, Lincoln, of course, refused to participate. I mean, he was running for president, but he didn't want to go to anywhere, give speeches and stuff like that. So he had his campaign workers, the people who were supporting him, do all the work for him. And we do get a very good idea of how that worked, you know, traveling from state to state on trains, making speeches, planting newspaper articles, reprinting Lincoln's own speeches. We really get an idea of how they ran the election for him. But the fact that he let other people run his own campaign really comes back to bite him, because by the middle of the episode, after he's elected, people reveal to him that they promised some other people who were in return for their support of Lincoln for president, they promised him, you know, government jobs, cabinet posts, stuff like that. And this was not something that Abraham Lincoln planned to do. Just the fact that political wheeling and dealing is not a new thing, it was really deeply in place in the 19th century, and that sense of politics is something that I was really glad to see here, that I was missing, I think, in earlier in Lincoln biopics that I've seen. Now, the second episode covers the controversies surrounding Mary Todd, who, because she had a southern family, was considered by some people to be a security risk, and even a possible traitor. Sada Thompson plays Mary Todd Lincoln, and it's a wonderful performance. You know, it has to walk a really delicate line, because she has to both invoke Mary's increasing instability, you know, paranoia, mental problems, lots of sadness rivaling even Lincoln's, but while still having a warm, loving, and affectionate relationship with Lincoln himself. It's a really complex performance, and it's really amazing that Sada Thompson pulls it off as well as she does. Now, the third episode is something completely different. It's a flashback to Lincoln's years as a prairie lawyer.
Our earnings. Mighty poor pickings.
Well, it'd be a good fee in the Truett case.
and I'll need all the help I can get. Taking your advice, I'm going to run for Congress against Douglas.
You whip the little giant.
Now, you'll have to take charge with Truitt. I'm going to need my time to campaign, and I intend to campaign like the very devil. What's that? Fee?
Farm mortgage case. Feller didn't have the $5, but I won for him. He's so grateful he's going to save us a bushel of corn next harvest.
A promissory note from the poor lad they're going to hang?
Oh, I meant to tear that up, John. Even if I'd got him off, I'd never been able to collect on him.
Now, why bother with a note?
Save his pride. Boy couldn't even write. Had to make the X mark where I pointed.
Yeah, I can see where defending Truitt don't set right with you. I don't have any tactics. Our client claims Dr. Ehrlich threatened him with a chair, so he shot him.
I had much use for Dr. Ehrlich. Psalm-singing hypocrite. Preaching God on one day and log rolling with the devil on the next. It don't mean he deserved to get killed. Truitt, he's just a loudmouth bully.
And the last few episodes of the series basically cover the same ground. It's about Abe's handling of the Civil War and Reconstruction, just trying to figure out what to do with the South during and after the war and when it was over. It's really kind of an odd thing about this miniseries that the Civil War happens almost entirely off-screen. We barely get a glimpse of the battles, and that's only just a little bit in the last episode, which is another flashback. And our sense of the progress is told mostly through second- and third-hand accounts told to and by Lincoln. I don't really know why this is. It could be budget restraints, could be having to work within the constraints of, you know, 70s-era television, which could limit scope a little bit. But I think it really kind of works almost entirely to the series' advantage because it focuses on Lincoln as a flesh-and-blood man. You know, he's not an icon here. He's a man. It takes a deep, long look at his personal and political life, while trying to avoid the things that really could give him a lot of glory and see him as a great leader, although he was a great leader, but he wanted to try to figure that out on our own rather than just show how he ran the military and stuff like that. This could also explain why some of his more famous speeches, such as the Gettysburg Address and his second inaugural address, are either glanced over or completely avoided altogether. The series was produced by David L. Wolper, who later produced the legendary slavery miniseries Roots. It was directed by George Schaefer, a veteran of the telefilm format, whose previous credits included an adaptation of Abe Lincoln in Illinois starring Jason Robards, The Bunker, which won Anthony Hopkins an Emmy for his portrayal of Adolf Hitler, and The Last of Mrs. Lincoln, which detailed the tragic final years of Mary Todd Lincoln's life. George Schaefer does a really good job of directing the series. I mean, He keeps the pacing going rather well. He has an interesting way of cutting back and forth between time and location, so we can get a sense of how people communicated at this time, you know, when telegraphs were considered revolutionary, and we didn't really have much of the communication technology that we have now. He has a really good eye for period detail. I mean, the costumes, the sets, I mean, the White House is absolutely stuffed with people trying to be able to get a meeting with Abraham Lincoln to try to get a job, and even though the story is very much set and based around the characters of Abraham Lincoln and Mary Todd, he really takes a good job at making sure the supporting characters are not lost in the shuffle. I mean, all the supporting characters have their moment to shine and have their own developments and influences in the overall story. And I want to point out a few of them. Some of the actors who played members of Lincoln's cabinet, who I found were particularly effective. There was Bert Freed as Edwin Stanton, Roy Poole as Salmon Chase, and Stephen Darden as Gideon Wells. All of them are very good at showing just how conflicted they are, you know, between their loyalty to party, to Lincoln, to the Union, what they see as the best, and how it conflicts with other people's ideas of what's the best. They're all really good, especially in the later episodes, the last two or three episodes of the series. The only real problem that I can think of with the pacing is the fact that, due to the fact that it was, of course, originally made for network television, there were commercial breaks, And some of the commercial breaks, I think, were meant to disguise some of the time skips, so when you're watching it on DVD, like I did, sometimes, you know, months or years can go by without warning, you know, coming out of nowhere. But of course, when you're actually watching this back when it was first broadcast in the 70s, there would be commercials there. But still, it is a creative way of splitting up the time period, but can get a little overwhelming when the watched one after the other. But still, I say if you have the time, really check out this miniseries. It's a great piece. It's a fabulous look at Abraham Lincoln. It even has historical value, not just as a Lincoln biography, but also as the first miniseries made for television. You can see how really the format hasn't changed that much, or perhaps how the earlier editions like this can seem to be differently made than the newer ones. And the fact that it really feels the need to show Lincoln as a man, not as an icon, not as a legend, makes it a very effective biography in and of itself. Sure, some of the individual parts aren't as good as the whole, but it is a very well worth watching miniseries. Now, for some trivia again, Hal Holbrook, like Raymond Massey and some of the other guys, would find himself very much identified with the role of Abraham Lincoln for a while, both before and after the making of this miniseries. He would reprise the role of Abraham Lincoln in the TV miniseries North and South and North and South Book 2. Both of these series were also produced by David L. Wolper. But believe it or not, Hal Holbrook's first on-screen performance as Abraham Lincoln was not in a miniseries or TV movie, but, of all places, as a guest spot on a 1966 episode of The Ed Sullivan Show.
Tonight, one of the fine artists of our country, Hal Holbrook, the brilliant interpreter of Abe Lincoln, offers Lincoln's second inaugural speech.
Fellow countrymen, at this second appearance to take the oath of the presidential office, there is less occasion for an extended address than there was at the first. 4 years ago, all thoughts were anxiously directed to an impending civil war. All dreaded it. All sought to avert it. Both parties deprecated war, but one of them would make war rather than let the nation survive, and the other would accept war rather than let it perish, and the war came.
Like Henry Fonda before him, Hal Holbrook will also find himself playing a number of fictional politicians over the years, including the U.S. President twice in the TV movies Under Siege, not to be confused with the Steven Seagal movie, and the other TV movie entitled The Kidnapping of a President. And just to bring everything full circle, he will also be seen in Steven Spielberg's Lincoln biopic, where he will be playing the elderly Republican journalist and power broker named James Preston Blair. And that is just about all I have for you here talking to all about Sandburg's Lincoln. Be sure to stop by again next time when I can tell you a bit more about portrayals of Lincoln on screen. Until then, thanks for watching.